Recorded Books and RB Digital present When Hell Struck 12, A Billy Boyle World War II Mystery by James R. Benn. Narrated by Peter Berkrot. This program concludes with a note narrated by the author. These verses believe. They love. They hope. That is all. Arthur Rimbaud. For Debbie and all that we believe. O childhood, the grass, the rain, the lake water on stones, the moonlight when the hell struck 12, the devil's in the tower right now. From Hellish Night by Arthur Rimbaud. Part 1. Falaise. Chapter 1. The Falaise Gap, Northern France, August 1944. The ground was a carpet of gray corpses. They lay on the hillside in scattered clumps, and on the valley floor below like a river flowing in from hell itself. Blasted by shells and bombs, ripped and torn by strafing aircraft, remnants of the once mighty German army in Normandy were dead or dying in droves as they tried to escape the trap closing in on them. Those desperate enough were struggling to flee the carnage, and the only way to do that was to drive us off this goddamn hill. Hill 262, according to the map. 262 meters high. It towered above the eastern road from Falaise and the green meadows littered with German dead, their field gray uniforms coated in swirling dust and caked crimson with blood. Across the valley, somewhere to the south, General Patton's Third Army was advancing on a long-end run to slam the door on the German escape route. Patton was drawing near, but not fast enough to stop the stream of surviving krauts from fighting their way out of the slowly closing trap. The enemy was in a tight spot, backed up on the road for 30 miles or so to the west, stuck in a shrinking pocket enveloped by Allied armies. But the pocket wasn't zipped up tight, not yet. We were in the right place, but not strong enough to lock it up. Patton's tanks were strong enough, but too far distant. Even so, the valley was a shooting gallery filled with burning vehicles and men dying as they made their way forward on foot. Everything from long-range artillery to tank shells hit the valley floor with explosive bursts, churning up earth and igniting fuel tanks, plumes of yellow flame and black smoke dotting the roadway for miles. The rancid odor of death rose up on the blisteringly hot winds from the valley below, clawing at the back of my throat. "Anything, Captain Boyle?" Lieutenant Felix Kansky asked, as I hunched over the radio in the back of my jeep, which was parked next to a shell-shattered tree trunk, camouflaged by tangled limbs and dying leaves. There were few safe places within the square mile we possessed on this hill, and I was glad of what cover it offered. I shook my head as I gave my call sign over and over again, broadcasting on the frequency we'd been assigned.
"Keep at it. We need ammunition," Felix said.
His face was gaunt, his skin pale under the filth of 3 days on this hilltop. Sweat poured down his temples under the distinctive British tin-pot helmet shading his eyes. Felix was with the Polish 1st Armored Division, as was everyone else on Hill 262. Well, not everyone. I was here, along with my buddy Kaz. Lieutenant Piotr Kazimierz, that is. Kaz was a member of the Polish army in exile, but he wasn't with Felix's frontline unit. He and I were part of a different outfit. We worked for General Eisenhower and wore the shoulder patch of the Supreme Headquarters Allied Expeditionary Force, Schaeff. We'd arrived yesterday as part of a Canadian supply column that had run into bad luck in the form of a couple of Panther tanks who got us in their sights and took out all six trucks. We'd been in a jeep, and either they didn't spot us or felt we weren't worth a high explosive shell. After that, Hill 262 had been surrounded. Tanks and German paratroopers attacked on one side, fanatical SS troops on the other. I gave Felix my canteen. There wasn't much left, but he needed it more than I did. He took a sip and handed it back as static crackled, and I finally heard a voice. In English, thankfully. It was the 4th Canadian Armored, and they had good news. I acknowledged the message and signed off. Supply drop at 0900, I said, which meant the planes were close. Felix grinned. Good, he said. I will pass the word. It is about time. We're down to 50 rounds per man. Some of the tanks have only a few shells left. The Poles had been fighting for days. That hadn't been part of the plan. By now, the northern and southern pincers should have linked up and had the crowds trapped within a deadly embrace. Instead, Hill 262 was on its own and struggling to hold on. Struggling in more ways than one. Every Polish soldier knew what surrender to the SS meant. Execution. With elements of two SS panzer divisions attacking from the west, trying to pry open an escape route for their pals inside the pocket, there was only one choice. Fight to the death. Every Pole on this hill knew about the Warsaw Uprising. The Polish Home Army had revolted and fought the Germans, expecting the Soviet Army to liberate the city. But the Russians had not come to their aid. They halted, allowing SS troops to pour in and put down the rebellion. Tens of thousands of civilians were massacred as the Russians waited for the Nazis to wipe out the Home Army, which they considered a potential threat to Soviet rule. No Polish soldier would expect any mercy from the SS, or give any, not after Warsaw, not after 5 years of ruthless occupation and that last terrible bloodbath. Shells exploded on the hillside, a reminder that the Germans in the valley still had deadly hardware and could use it effectively. Artillery sounded from the north, the 4th Canadian Armored boys trying to fight their way through the crowd paratroopers to get at us, and having a tough time of it. Small arms fire crackled along the line, but it was impossible to tell who was shooting at whom and with what effect. I dashed over to Kaz, shells falling closer and closer. He was in a trench near an old hunting lodge, the only building on the hill. It had been pressed into service as a hospital and was crammed with wounded, Pole and German alike. Outside the lodge, several hundred prisoners were huddled together, guarded by Polish soldiers who'd been bandaged up but could manage guard duty. Did you get through? Kaz asked, removing his steel-rimmed spectacles and cleaning them with the spotless white handkerchief he had managed to produce from one of his pockets. Monogrammed, no less, with his initials and family crest. Kaz may have been a lowly lieutenant in the eyes of the army, but he was a baron of the Augustus clan, and probably one of the few Polish nobles left alive. Yeah, a Canadian pal said an airdrop of supplies is on the way. These guys giving you any trouble?
None at all,
Kaz said, putting on his glasses and gazing out over the sullen prisoners sitting on trampled grass, his Sten gun resting on the lip of the trench. It might have been the submachine gun or the terrible scar that cut across the side of Kaz's face. Both were frightening enough. I think most are glad to be out of the war, or in shock from the experience in that valley. I unslung my Thompson submachine gun and leaned against the trench wall. Kaz was right. By the looks on their faces, these Fritzes had had enough. They'd come through the Valley of Death and been captured by Polish tankers. Lucky to have survived both, few of them saw any percentage in making a run for it. If they weren't killed outright, all they had to look forward to was more fighting and a high likelihood of dying on the dusty road to Paris. Everybody wanted to get to Paris. GIs dreamt of it, a magical, near-mythical place of life, joy, wine, and women. French resistance fighters wanted it for everything it meant to their nation still in chains. Germans wanted it for the safety it promised, or perhaps as a last chance for glamorous living and loot to carry back to the Reich. I had my own reasons for getting to Paris. Still no SS? I asked Kaz, after a quick survey of the POWs. No, Kaz replied. No SS prisoners. They fight to the end. As to our men, we are in France, but between Poles and the SS, it is still Poland. It is still Warsaw. Fine by me, I said. Last thing we need are diehard Nazis talking these boys into making a break for it.
The POWs were the reason we were here. One of our jobs in the Chief Office of Special Investigations was prisoner interrogation. Well, one of Kaz's jobs, to tell the truth. He was the one who spoke half a dozen languages fluently and a bunch of others passably. When we had nothing that needed actual investigating, our boss put us on this detail, which had only extended to receiving the prisoners when they were brought back from the front lines. But Kaz couldn't wait. He wanted to catch up with his Polish brethren, Felix in particular. Felix had intelligence contacts with the Home Army in occupied Poland, and Kaz had recently discovered that his younger sister Angelica was still alive, which was a very good thing. But she was working with the Polish underground, a very dangerous thing. With the Warsaw Uprising and the slaughter of Polish civilians and fighters by the Nazis, Kaz was desperate to obtain whatever information he could. So we invited ourselves along on that supply run. The brass wanted prisoners, especially officers, to interrogate about the Kraut plans to defend Paris. That was the next stop on this campaign, once we bagged the remnants of the German army in the valley below, which I'm sure had looked a whole lot easier on paper. The Poles had a good haul of prisoners, but no place to hold them. Our role should have been a walk in the park, bring in the supplies and drive out the most senior POWs in the empty trucks. But war had a way of making even the simplest plan an unimaginable mess, and here we were smack in the middle of one. Felix hadn't heard a damn thing about Angelica. The trucks were blown to hell and gone, and we were battling enemy forces intent on overrunning our position and hightailing it to the City of Light, or wherever the Krauts were planning on making their next stand. "Do you hear it?" Kaz said, nudging me as he kept one eye on the prisoners. I did. The low rumble of C-47 cargo planes approaching. Shouts and cheers went up from the Poles dug in around us. Even the German prisoners looked happy, understanding with a soldier's intuition that this sound meant chow and cigarettes. "There!" Kaz pointed to the north as the sound of twin-engine aircraft grew in intensity, their throbbing engines becoming louder and more insistent. Then the first planes appeared, drawing closer as parachutes fell behind them, blossoming against the bright blue sky. Dozens of canisters floated beneath the white canopies as the flight of C-47s banked away from the anti-aircraft fire rising from the valley floor. I kept my eye on the parachutes. They were too far away. The first ones landed far short of our positions, close to the Germans at the base of the hill. The rest drifted, snarling their cords in the trees on a ridgeline a quarter of a mile or more away. A groan went up from the men dug in around us. Even the prisoners looked disappointed. "That's where we left from yesterday," Kaz said. "They dropped them to the Canadians, the fools." "They'll break through to us," I said, trying to sound confident. "And they'll bring the supplies. It won't be long." "We should have been back by now, interrogating these Nazi officers," Kaz said, swinging his Sten gun to take in the prisoners sitting in the grass. Some of them ducked. Others laughed disdainfully at this unseemly display of nerves on the part of their Kameraden. "Perhaps we should start. We have a major and several captains here." "Now," I said, "we need to separate them. The guy won't snitch if he knows he's going to be tossed back in the clink with his pals. Too dangerous." That was one of the first things my dad taught me back in Boston. He was a homicide detective, and he had started training me to follow in the family business before I was in long pants. "Yes, I see," Kaz said. "Besides, some of them may believe they will be freed after the next attack. They may have guessed we are low on ammunition." As if on cue, mortar rounds sailed over our heads, exploding around us. This time, everyone ducked. I told Kaz to stay put and ran low as another flurry of explosions dropped in among the entrenchments. It was another attack. We were dug in deep, so mortar rounds weren't much of a threat, unless your foxhole took a direct hit. But it did tend to make you keep your head down, which was a problem if a few hundred pissed-off Krauts were advancing in your direction. I ran by tanks, camouflaged by leafy branches and hidden in the rocky terrain. There was no activity on the hillside facing the valley road, just the ceaseless grump of distant artillery punishing the Germans below. I scuttled along behind the men, dug in all along the ridge. Nothing sounded other than the occasional rippling rattle of rifle fire. On the northwest side of the hill, it was much the same. I dove into a foxhole already crowded with Poles manning a machine gun, as another round of mortar fire sent shrapnel flying. I risked a quick glance above the logs protecting the gunners. Off to the left, a gully ran down the hill, dotted with the bodies of Germans who tried to break through. These were the SS trying to loosen our hold on this hill, so their pals could get out of the trap. By the twisted tangles of corpses, I didn't see them trying that route again. On the right flank, the ground sloped gently downward, a line of trees and shrubs to the side obscuring my vision. I strained to see any sign of movement through the greenery, but no dice. One of the Poles used his binoculars and shook his head as he let them drop to his chest. Nothing. My gaze wandered to the grassy field in front of us. Between the gully and the trees, tall grasses browned by the August sun bent as a warm gust brushed against them. No sign of crowds. Then I saw it. Clumps of grass that didn't bend with the breeze. Camouflage stuck on helmets. The enemy crawling silently forward on their bellies, as we looked in all the obvious places. Scorpi, I said, nudging the gunner. He nodded, having just spotted them. His loader lifted the belt of the 30-caliber ammo from the metal box and held it up. He had less than 50 rounds. There were a lot more Scorpi than that. Kaz said it meant castrated ram, and the Free Poles had adopted it as slang for the SS. I'll get more ammo, I said, and rolled out of the emplacement. I ran back to the tanks, ignoring the explosions that were becoming less frequent. That was not good. It meant the castrated rams were getting closer. Krauts! I yelled to Felix, who was up in the turret shouting into his radio. I told him where and that we needed 30-caliber ammo. We are out, damn it! He yelled, throwing down the receiver. The relief column is still held up. How many? Hard to say. A couple hundred at least. They're crawling up the grassy slope, going slow. They don't know we've spotted them, I said. The machine gun covering that ground is down to their last belt. We can't depress our guns to shoot downhill either, Felix said. If they break through, it will be a slaughter. But we still have these. He patted the big 50-caliber machine gun mounted on the turret. It was mainly for anti-aircraft protection, and the way it was set up, the gunner would have to stand exposed to enemy fire to use it. Risky. But with the Luftwaffe absent from the skies, there was a lot of ammo left. Felix signaled to one of the other tanks, and their treads spat dirt as they turned and rumbled off to the ridgeline. Felix and the other tank commander held onto their guns, feet braced on the tank's hull as they moved forward. I ran ahead to the machine gun pit, where the gunners were nodding their heads. They'd heard the tanks, felt the ground tremble as they approached, and knew help was at hand. I prayed it was enough. The Germans, crawling on their bellies, must have felt the tanks coming as well. They rose up, running and screaming, firing as they came, all pretense of stealth abandoned as they made for the thin line of trenches dug in along the ridge. The gunner squeezed off a few rounds, aiming carefully. Men fell, but more came on. Bullets thumped into the logs and sandbags, zinging through the air above our heads and kicking up stones and dirt all around us. The gunner's head snapped back, a bullet above one eye. His loader pushed the body away and fired, going through most of the ammo in his rage. Where was Felix? I could hear the roar of the Sherman's radial engine, but no firing. I fired my Thompson as the gunner finished off his ammo. He grabbed a rifle and began firing. Up and down the line, men shot at the advancing SS with slow, deliberate volleys, each man counting down to his final bullet. There were too many of them. Some dropped dead, others rolled in the grass clutching wounds, but far more pressed on, faces blackened with dirt and gunpowder, snarling screams fueled by doses of schnapps, fanaticism, and hatred for the subhuman Poles. They came closer. The man next to me fired his last bullet. I handed him my pistol as a grenade exploded, showering us with dirt. I tossed my last grenade down the hill, screaming for Felix as the Krauts got close enough to make out the SS runes on their collar tabs. An engine roared directly above us, the Sherman's treads halting inches from my head. The 50-caliber machine gun spewed fire. Felix's enraged screams loud enough to be heard between bursts. The rounds shattered the Germans, the second tank joining in with a crossfire that caught the SS in the open, ripping into flesh and bone, turning men into plumes of pink mist. The machine guns were loaded with tracer rounds, bullets with a pyrotechnic charge that lit up and helped gunners aim at moving aircraft. Hitting men at this range, it set their clothing and flesh afire. The tracers ignited the dry grass, the wind fanning the flames as the SS tried to fall back, bullets striking them, sending up sprays of blood, severing limbs, slamming the dead and wounded into the burning earth. "Warszawa! Warszawa!" The chant rose up from along the lines, men standing and shaking their fists as Felix and the other tanker unleashed their orgy of death. The grass burned. The dead and wounded burned. Shrieks of pain overcame even the chatter of the machine guns, which finally ceased for lack of targets. I stood as well, listening to the Poles shout their revenge for the massacres in Warsaw. In the midst of all the yelling, I heard a familiar voice and saw Kaz join us. He chanted Warszawa with the rest of them, tears streaming through the dirt and dust on his cheeks. The last shots and shouts faded away as the Poles stopped, stunned at their victory. Felix jumped down from his tank, pistol at the ready. But there was no need. The smoke-filled field held only the dead and dying. Several SS troopers tried to drag themselves through the fire, their uniforms smoldering. Their cries and screams died as they did, bleeding, choking, and burning before us. "Let them burn," Kaz said, his jaw clenched tight. "Hell is too good for them." "Niech płonie," Felix said, adding his agreement. I found nothing in that sentiment to argue with. What strange creatures this war has made of us.
Chapter 2.
"I am sorry I have no news of Angelica," Felix said, "but I will ask our intelligence people if there has been any word. After the uprising, radio contact was very difficult."
"Bury your dead and get some sleep," Kaz said, "but find out what you can when the time is right. I feel as if I may sleep forever, or never again," Felix said, lighting a cigarette and looking out over the valley below. Explosions blossomed like a garland of black flowers across a distant field. A plume of sudden red and orange marked a fuel tank taking a direct hit. We watched the carnage, smiling. Shkopi were dying, and that was good. Fewer of them to face on the road to Paris. The Canadians had broken through 2 hours ago. They brought the ammunition and supplies and were busy evacuating the wounded. They'd even brought 300 body bags for the dead. Felix told them to get more.
"If you learn anything, contact Colonel Harding at 12th Army Group," Kaz said. "He will know where to find me."
Harding was our boss in the small club that was the Chief Office of Special Investigations. 12th Army Group was the top American headquarters in France, not counting Chief's own advance headquarters, where General Eisenhower hung his hat.
"I will," Felix promised as we shook hands. "Good luck with your prisoners."
"They're good and scared after that last attack," I said. "Nothing like a ringside seat at your own army's destruction to loosen tongues." I got into the driver's seat of the Jeep and waited while Kaz and Felix exchanged a few private words. It seemed to me that Felix had known Angelica pretty well back in Poland when they were working with the Home Army, as they called their underground. Felix's identity had been blown, and he had to go on the run, escaping to Sweden and eventually England. Each man had his own reasons for worrying about Angelica, so I left them to it. In front of me, a truck waited with our first batch of prisoners. One infantry major, a captain in the supply office, one lieutenant from an engineer company, and another from a signals unit. It wasn't hard to pick them out. The Germans used different colors on their shoulder tabs and caps to designate the branch of service. I took the major since he was the highest rank available. The supply captain might have some idea where supplies were being stockpiled, which would tell us where the Krauts might try to rally. Same thing with the engineer if he was involved in building defensive positions.
and signal guys ran wire, which had to be hooked up to a higher headquarters. So that's how I ended up with these four representatives of the master race, all sitting glumly under the watchful eye of their Canadian guards. "Shall we?" Kaz said, taking his seat and holding his Sten gun at the ready. Not that I thought our prisoners were about to jump their guards and vault off a moving truck. Still, a little intimidation wouldn't hurt. I gave the high sign to the truck driver, and long after I had expected to, we left Hill 262 behind. Sam Harding was waiting for us at the Canadian Divisional Headquarters at Saint-Gervais. HQ was set up in a forest overlooking the village. Camouflage netting was strung up, covering vehicles and tents beneath the trees. Colonel Samuel Harding was a regular army, a veteran of the First World War, and a stickler for following orders. Even so, he was a decent guy. But he didn't look at all pleased to see us.
"What the hell did you two idiots think you were doing?"
Harding demanded as the jeep rolled to a halt.
"Colonel, it was all my fault," Kaz said, exiting the jeep as he kept one eye and the barrel of his weapon trained on the prisoners.
"Lieutenant Kazimierz, it cannot be your fault since you went off with a superior officer, right, Captain Boyle?"
"Yes, sir," I said, getting up and standing at what might be thought of as attention. I liked everything about being a captain, except for when it made me responsible for whatever trouble Kaz had led us into. He wasn't much for following orders either. Probably came from being a baron.
"You could have gotten Lieutenant Kazimierz killed on your damn joyride. You were to wait here for the prisoners, Boyle."
"Colonel, Kaz was looking for information about his sister. You remember Felix, the guy with the home army contacts?"
"I don't give a good goddamn about Felix," Harding yelled.
He kept on yelling for a while, and I gave myself a mental kick in the pants for not remembering to simply say yes, sir, over and over again when a senior officer gets himself in a snit.
"I give orders for a reason, you two. Obeying orders is not optional. Do you understand?"
He jabbed a finger at both of us. I hadn't seen him this worked up in a while.
"Sam, come on, don't bust the gasket,"
Big Mike said, patting Harding on the shoulder.
"It's not their fault the Poles got surrounded, is it?"
"Damn it, Big Mike," Harding said, shaking off the hand on his shoulder. It was a big hand.
Staff Sergeant Mike Misnikowski lived up to his nickname. He was broad in the shoulders, tall, and had a neck like a fire plug. But he was as gentle as a lamb when he wanted to be, and soothing words along with hands the size of ham hocks often served him well.
"Got a good haul of prisoners?"
Big Mike asked, changing the subject as quickly as possible.
"We did," I said, telling Harding about the officers and the other prisoners following us.
There was a POW cage nearby, and they could cool their heels in there while we interrogated our first four Fritzes.
"Okay,"
Colonel Harding said, his blood pressure seeming to return to normal.
"You need to rest up before questioning these four?"
"We both could use some shut-eye, sir. But we ought to get to these prisoners while they're still in shock," I said. It was true. And I also knew Harding well enough to know self-sacrifice appealed to him. They'd been through hell in that valley, and they saw the aftermath of an attack by the SS. Their pals got pretty chewed up. I don't want to give them time to get over it.
"Good," Harding said. "I'll get the Canadians working on the lower ranks while you get started on the officers. Anything to do with the Paris defenses is critical."
"How about this?"
Big Mike said.
"Billy and Kaz grab some Joe in a quick bite while I take the Krauts and treat them real nice. Coffee and smokes. Let them relax. Then I'll bring them to you one by one."
"Good cop, bad cop," I said. Big Mike was a Detroit patrolman before the war, so he knew the routine. He was blue through and through, still carried his shield. "We can make that work." Kaz and I headed toward the smell of food. The mess was set up in a large granite barn with wide doors at either end open to the breeze. We loaded up our mess kits with coffee, corned beef hash, and biscuits. Hot Joe and warm food never tasted so good. After wolfing down my grub like a starving man, I sat back and surveyed the room. Lots of Canadians, of course, sporting their spiffy tankers' berets. A fair number of French resistance fighters as well. tough-looking fighters. Their armbands marked FFI. The Forces Francais de l'Intérieur. French Forces of the Interior. But everyone called them Fifis. Some armbands were also emblazoned with the Cross of Lorraine, the symbol of General Charles de Gaulle's Free France. But that was all the uniform they had. They were dressed in everything from a three-piece suit to a working man's blue coverall, or shorts with loose collarless shirts, and a handful of skirts and dresses as well. Women carried weapons along with the men. They were attired with a bit more flair, but just as deadly. "Perhaps we could enlist the help of the Fifis," Kaz said as he finished his coffee. "I was thinking the Poles," I said. My plan, such as it was, involved a threat to turn our prisoners over to the Polish troops, with Kaz playing the role of the heavy. That could work, but our prisoners are not SS. They would certainly worry about being delivered into Polish hands, but the Poles are still uniformed soldiers. Not so with the Fifis. "You're right," I said. Any crowd who'd been part of the occupation would have reason to worry about being turned over to the resistance, especially since they were civilians with no military control to speak of, and a good number of communists in their ranks. Let's see if they'll play along. Kaz nodded. He got a refill of coffee and stopped by a group of Fifis. Kaz being Kaz, he selected the group with a couple of women, and soon he had them all at our table. The women had German MP-40 submachine guns slung over their shoulders, while the men carried German rifles. None of them looked a day over 20. "Billy, this is Jules Herbert and Marie-Claire Merel," Kaz said. "They both speak English. I've explained what we require, and they are happy to help, along with Florent and Raymond." "Maybe you give us one of the Boches, yes?" Jules said, with enough of a laugh to show he was joking, but would appreciate the gesture if we were so inclined. "Sorry," I said, "but we work for General Eisenhower, and he wants these prisoners accounted for." "Eisenhower," Marie-Claire said, clearly impressed. She and the others chatted in French for a moment. "Have you met General de Gaulle?" "No," I said, "but he is a great man." I wasn't sure about the leader of the Free French, but I figured it was what they wanted to hear. By the argument that broke out among them, I'd figured wrong.
"Yes, yes," Jules said, holding up a hand to stop the squabbling. "We all agree de Gaulle was right to not give up when the Germans occupied France. But some think he waits safely in London while we fight and die. Then he will come in and declare himself the head of the new government." "And why should he not be in London?" Marie-Claire said. "He is the head of the army. This army, the FFI, and the French forces in uniform. Who else is there?"
I watched the other two men roll their eyes at what seemed to be a familiar argument. They didn't speak English, but I could tell they'd heard it all before. Shaking his head and grinning, one of them gave Jules a gentle shove.
"All right," Jules said, looking a bit embarrassed. "We will not bore you with our politics, Captain." "Jules is with the FTP, Marie-Claire said. "The Franc-Tireurs et Partisans. They are the fighting arm of the French Communist Party. So he has his opinions about General de Gaulle."
"And Marie-Claire is with the Catholic Youth Network La Croix," Jules said, laying a hand on hers.
"She is very brave, and a good shot, but so bourgeois."
This time it was Marie-Claire who gave him a shove, and that got a laugh. It wasn't hard to see that these two young fighters were head over heels in love with each other, no matter their political differences.
"Are you a communist?" Kaz asked Jules. "I understand not every FTP fighter is." "Yes, I am, and proud as well," Jules said. "My unit is the Saint-Just Brigade, and we are all dedicated Marxists. We fight and have killed many Boches, and lost many of our own."
"I applaud your courage," Kaz said. "But allow me to say it is easy to be a proud communist when you have never had the opportunity to live under their rule. As a Pole, I know this all too well."
"But Stalin is helping to liberate your nation from the Nazis," Jules said.
"Be thankful the Russians are not liberating France, young man. They might overstay their welcome, Kaz said.
Now, enough of politics. Let us plan the farce we will play out for our German guests.
We had a tent, shielded from view by camouflage netting. Just right for giving the prisoners privacy, as well as getting them to worry about a lack of witnesses. Big Mike escorted the leadoff player in, aided by Raymond and Florent. Jules and Marie Claire stood at the entrance, scowls of hatred directed at the Boche paraded before them. We sat the major down. He looked nervous. Big Mike stood outside with the partisans while Kaz went through a few basic questions with our guest. He was Major Wilhelm Fischer, infantry, as was obvious by his collar tab. He kept up a stern face until Kaz explained that we needed information, and if he didn't give it to us, he'd end up giving it to the FTP. Fischer protested, probably going on about the Geneva Convention and not being turned over to French civilians, communists no less. Perhaps I should suggest my Polish friends, Kaz said to me. They wear uniforms and are definitely not Reds. I agreed. Kaz made his offer, which got Major Fischer all in a tizzy.
Nein, bitte.
He actually wept. Kaz talked to him in a calm voice, but he only got more agitated. What's the deal? I asked.
He says his men are all dead or captured. He doesn't know anything about Paris or the defenses there. His unit had no orders other than to escape and head in that direction, for the Seine River. Needless to say, he dislikes the idea of being given to the French or the Poles. You believe him?
I think so. I shall tell him we will give him to the French if we find out he's been lying when we talk to the other prisoners.
Kaz laid it out for the Major, and by the look on his face, I decided he was telling the truth. His story made sense. The Seine, which ran right through Paris, was the next logical defensive line for the Germans. And in a chaotic retreat, there wouldn't have been time for more precise orders. Big Mike took him away, and we repeated the process for the supply captain and the engineer lieutenant. The captain's supply column had been shot up and bombed. The engineer had been ordered to blow up a bridge over the Dive River but had no explosives. They were stunned and frightened at what had happened during the retreat through the filet's pocket. The threat of being turned over to the partisans scared them even more. But their expressions told me they'd have sung like stool pigeons if they had any information worth trading for their lives. The last POW was our best hope. Unless he was a signals officer who hadn't seen a radio in weeks.
Good news,
Big Mike said, ushering in the nervous lieutenant, who kept looking over his shoulder at the partisans outside, leering at him with undisguised glee.
Heinz speaks English. Ja, Heinz.
Ja, I do, Heinz said. Please, what happened to the others?
What others? I asked.
The other officers. The other three you took away.
I haven't seen any German officers, Heinz. At least no live ones, I said, almost feeling sorry for the guy. Big Mike shoved him by the shoulders into a chair, where he sat hunched over as if expecting to be beaten.
Have you seen any, Kaz?
Who keeps track of a few German officers here and there? Kaz said. So many people go missing in wartime, don't they, Heinz?
I do not know,
he managed to stammer.
Sure you do, I said. Like all the Jews who went missing in Germany and then in France, and the hostages who were taken and shot by your people.
I am not part of that, he said, sitting up a little straighter. I transmit signals. I do not give orders.
But you read them. Orders coming in and orders going out, I said.
What do those orders say about the defense of Paris?
Paris? I know nothing about Paris. I have been there on leave twice, but I have nothing to do with defending it.
He looked back and forth between Kaz and me, struggling to find a sympathetic face.
Where were you headed? Where was your unit going? I asked.
The Geneva Convention says I am not required to give that information, he said.
That's right,
I said, snapping my fingers. I guess we need to find someone who hasn't signed the Geneva Convention. Any ideas, Kaz?
The Front Tireur et Partisan, he said. I am certain the French Communist Party did not sign.
No, please, Heinz said, holding up one hand in supplication. You do not understand. There were no orders. It was a retreat, not organized. There is a word for it.
Rout, I offered.
Yes, a rout. We destroyed our equipment to make more room in the trucks for the men. Then the Yabos came. Machine guns, rockets, and bombs. Those who lived walked. My commanding officer said to get across the Seine and then regroup. The last I saw him, he was in a ditch with his legs blown off. A rout, yes. That is the word.
Yabos. Crowd slang for the fighter bombers that plagued their every daylight move. His story was the same as the others gave. Confusion, terror, desperation. As true as that was, one of these bastards could be hiding something. So I tried my last trick. Sorry, Heinz, but I don't believe you. It's time for you to take a walk in the woods with our French allies, I said.
What? No,
Heinz said, his mouth gaping open in fear.
You don't mean with the terrorists, do you?
Une promenade dans le bois, Kaz said. You must have picked up some French, Lieutenant. I am sure they will treat you with all the fairness you deserve.
No, wait,
Heinz said. His eyes darted back and forth as if he was reviewing every message he ever sent, searching for something of value. Your time is up, I said. I hope you enjoyed your stay in France. It's about to become permanent.
The terrorists,
Heinz whispered, using the term the Krauts employed to describe those who dared to strike back at them.
I can tell you something about them.
About the partisans? Kaz said, glancing at Big Mike and the four partisans standing outside the tent. They weren't listening.
Yes, but will that be enough? I know nothing about the Paris defenses, but I can tell you something of the terrorists. I mean, partisans. If you will not turn me over to them.
Okay, Heinz, it's a deal. Spill. He wrinkled his forehead trying to work that one out. Tell us everything.
Yes, I understand. The intelligence chief of my division often worked with the Malichi. You know who they are?
Yeah, I said. We knew them all too well. French fascist militia who did a lot of dirty work for the Germans. They hunted the partisans and were often used to infiltrate their ranks. What's your division?
The 91st Infantry. Colonel Schmidt used the Malichi to gather information on the partisans. But he also had his own contact with a partisan leader, Heinz said.
A leader? Kaz said.
All I know is that this man led a group of terrorists and passed on information to my colonel, Heinz said. I sent messages to army headquarters in Paris about it.
What's the man's name? I said. This was getting interesting.
Atlantik, Heinz said.
His code name, Kaz said.
Yes, of course. He would not use his real name, even to his compatriots,
Heinz said.
And the intelligence people only use code names.
Is that enough? Just about, I said. What kind of information did he pass on?
Names. Names of other leaders in his group. He was with the Franc Tireur Partisans, the Bolsheviks. Colonel Schmidt once said Atlantik hated Russia and the communists. Very much.
Yet he served with them, I asked. Why did he betray them?
The French,
Heinz said, giving a small shrug, as if that was the answer to this mystery. But perhaps he'd never given it much thought at all. He was a radio man, after all, just the messenger. It was up to us to make sense of it all, and figure out who the hell Atlantik was.
Chapter 3.
Hey, Sam, I think we got something,
Big Mike said when we found Colonel Harding in his tent, standing over a map of the Paris area spread out on a table. A look passed between them, and I got the impression they knew something I didn't, which was often the case, but Big Mike's tone told me the news of Heinz's story was even more important than I'd thought. Harding looked up, irritated at the interruption, his fingers still on the map where he'd been following one of the main routes into Paris. Most officers would have been annoyed at a sergeant calling them by their first name, but Big Mike had such a disarming way of doing it that Harding usually let it slide, especially if no other brass was around. Besides, Big Mike was an excellent scrounger, and when you have a big, muscular non-com who can obtain whatever's needed without a lot of army paperwork, even a colonel will cut him some slack.
What? Harding said, giving Big Mike a discreet nod. I guess that meant he didn't need to hold back.
One of the Kraut POWs told us about a resistance leader who's rotten. He's been betraying his own men to the Germans. He might help move things along, Big Mike said.
Help what along? Kaz asked.
I'll explain in a minute, Lieutenant. But first tell me who the guy is. Which resistance group? Harding said.
We only know the code name the Germans gave him. Atlantik.
And that he's with the Franc-Tireure Partisans, I said.
Also, he hates the communists, Kaz said. But our POW could not explain why he was with the FTP, given that hatred, since they are filled with Reds.
He simply transmitted messages about him. It was the divisional intelligence officer who knew Atlantik.
The FTP is everywhere, Harding said. They're the largest armed resistance group in France. Your German didn't know which FTP band this traitor is with?
No, sir. But Heinz was a signals officer with the 91st Infantry Division. If we knew the area they operated in, that could narrow it down, I said.
They've been all over Normandy, Harding said, checking another map. We ran up against them at Utah Beach, then on the Cherbourg Peninsula. Lately, they've been fighting to the west of here. Not much help.
We could comb the POW cages for officers from the 91st, I said. We might get lucky and find their intelligence chief alive. He might be persuaded to lead us to Atlantik. There's no telling how many deaths he's responsible for.
Cruel deaths at the hands of the Gestapo, Kaz said. He should be made to pay.
Yeah, Harding said, barely listening as he stared at the map. I need to call HQ. Wait here.
That was interesting, I said after Harding was gone.
We sat on the empty crates while Big Mike grabbed the one chair. Fair enough. He'd probably crush the thin slats on the pine boxes. I rose to study the map and the roads leading into Paris, wondering what kind of fight the Nazis were going to put up there. They just destroyed Warsaw. Was Paris next?
Yes, Kaz said, shaking up the crease in his trousers, even though his uniform was stained with the dirt and blood of Hill 262. He wore it like a tuxedo.
There is much you and the colonel are not telling us, Big Mike. We are talking of bringing a traitor to justice. Something tells me you and he have another plan entirely.
Sorry, I can't dish until Sam says it's okay. Need to know, you know?
Big Mike said, enjoying his secret.
And we don't need to know, I said, completing the refrain. So let's figure it out.
I do like puzzles, Kaz said, sitting up even straighter. Where do we start?
At the beginning, I said. We're sent off to bring POWs back here for interrogation. Big Mike and the colonel stay behind.
Why didn't the big lug come with us?
The colonel said it didn't take three of us, Kaz answered.
He was right. It shouldn't have.
I did tell him I wanted to go because of Felix and my fellow Poles, which he understood.
Right. Then we jumped the gun, nearly got ourselves killed, but made it back with a haul of POWs. Then Harding blew his top, I said, trying to break things down and understand what happened every step of the way.
It was a trick my dad taught me back when I was a rookie. He always did his best to show me the ropes. I didn't always pay attention, because I thought there would always be time to learn. Now I knew better. But breaking things down stuck with me. Dad had said it was important to notice the little things, and figure out why they'd happened, not just accept them at face value.
The colonel was very upset, Kaz said. He has lectured us sternly in the past, but today was different.
Why? I asked.
Kaz was right. We'd taken tongue lashings before, but this was different. Anger and impatience were normal, but Harding had been emotional, which was rare.
He was concerned we would have gotten ourselves killed for nothing, he said.
Or he was upset because he would have blamed himself, I said.
This is war, Billy, Kaz said. People get killed. But you are right. There was something in how he reacted. And his response about Atlantik was odd. But not to him, I said. That was another thing Dad taught me. Unless you're dealing with a fool, which Harding wasn't, it was a mistake to write off unusual behavior as an unexplainable quirk. Find the motivation, and it won't seem so odd anymore.
Yes, I see, Kaz said. So Atlantik will prove useful in whatever plan the Colonel is working on.
The plan he is calling headquarters about right now.
Deception, I said. He's going to use this traitor in a deception campaign.
How we doing, Big Mike? He made a zipper motion across his mouth, but by his barely stifled grin, I knew I was on the right track.
It must have something to do with Paris, Kaz said, standing to get a better look at the map and tracing his fingers on the roads leading to the city and the River Seine. Ah, Paris. Beautiful in springtime. Not so much in August.
Paris, I said, leaning over the map. There were grease pencil marks on the roads leading to Paris, and other routes to the south, lines marking the advance of Allied formations. But where were the German defensive lines? No wonder Harding was so desperate for information. He didn't have a clue where the Krauts were going to put up a fight.
Everyone wants to get to Paris, Kaz said. The Nazis, de Gaulle, all the resistance factions, and every Allied soldier in Normandy.
Of course they did. So did I. Who doesn't want to go to Paris?
Then I understood. I knew who didn't want to go to Paris. General Eisenhower and the entire Allied army. And I understood why Harding was so upset about our gallivanting off the Hill 262. It's a ruse, I said.
What is? Kaz said.
The whole quest for POWs who might know anything about the Paris defenses. Remember, one part of a good deception campaign is painting a believable picture. POWs, Canadians, the Poles, the FFI, us. We're all part of this effort to create the illusion we're frantic for dope on the Paris defenses.
We are not? Kaz asked.
I'd say no. We've got the Krauts on the run. Whatever part of their army in Normandy we didn't destroy, or bag in fillets, is hightailing it for Paris. The Seine is a natural defensive position.
Paris is home to millions of people, and some of the great art treasures of the world, Kaz said, thinking it through.
Yes, it would be a tremendous advantage for the Germans to fight there.
So why not go around it? Our armor can chew up the retreating Germans and leave the rest sitting in Paris. It'd be like one big fancy POW camp. We might even get over the Rhine before winter.
Still zipped up, Big Mike?
Tight, was all he had to say.
I am glad we were unhurt as a result of our unauthorized trip to Hill 262, Kaz said. Colonel Harding would never have forgiven himself for sending us on a mere deception errand if we had been killed.
So thoughtful of you, I said. Okay, Big Mike, let us in on the secret. How does Atlantik fit into this?
He made the zipper move again.
Atlantik is a traitor, Kaz said, tapping his finger on the map, marking the blank places where German entrenchments should have been. Therefore, he can be useful. If he believes the story created for him.
The story of the Allied plan to take Paris, I said, bending over the map for a closer look at the intersecting lines of rivers, roads, and ridges.
If the Krauts believe we're going after Paris, they'll fortify it, bring in all the troops who escaped the trap at Falaise. Then we swing around and cut them off.
If that is the plan, I see the military reason for it, Kaz said.
But what about the people of Paris? There are millions, with hardly enough food as it is.
If this scheme brings more German troops into the city, they could starve.
This is war, gentlemen, Harding said as he strode back into the tent. We're here to defeat the enemy as quickly as possible.
That's what Operation Frigate is all about.
Sounds nautical, Colonel, Kaz said.
This is a strictly land-based operation, Harding said. But frigates are fast ships, very maneuverable, so it's an apt name. Pack up your gear. I'll fill you in on the way back to Third Army HQ.
Harding looked excited, or at least what passed for excited when it came to his usually stony countenance. I almost said something about risking our lives for a deception campaign, but I didn't want to spoil his good mood. Besides, I had the feeling there were plenty more risks to come. I knew a thing or two about ships. I'd walked a beat close to the South Boston Naval Annex, part of the big Boston Navy Yard. I'd seen the frigates they built there. Solid little ships, just right for dropping depth charges on submerged submarines. But lightly armed, and no match for the faster destroyers and cruisers looking over the horizon. And what was over the horizon to the east was a badly beaten but still deadly army.
Chapter 4 Patton's moved up to St. Hilaire, Harding said from the front seat, as Big Mike gunned the jeep and sent us careening down a rutted path. There's a chateau outside of town where the Third Army is setting up headquarters. Things are moving pretty fast, Big Mike said, glancing at me and Kaz as he rounded a bend, a meek glimmer of apology flitting across his face.
Geez, Big Mike, keep your eyes on the road, will you? I said, gripping the side of the jeep.
Just because the Krauts didn't kill us, there's no reason for you to have a go at it. Sorry, fellas, but we don't have much time, Big Mike said, as he took a turn onto a wider country lane. We've got a lot to set up.
Colonel, Kaz said, tapping Harding on the shoulder. I believe this road leads to Lofrene, which is on the south side of the Falaise Pocket.
It's the quickest route, Harding said. Reports are this area has been cleared of Germans.
Reports? I said. I wasn't much for betting my life on an army report.
Air reconnaissance and the French resistance, he said. Both report the tail end of the Kraut retreat passed through here a few hours ago. All that's left are dead, wounded, and maybe a few shell-shocked stragglers.
Flyboys and fifis, huh? I said, as I checked my Thompson for a full clip.
Let's hope none of those stragglers try to jump us for the jeep.
If I was a straggler anxious to make it back to the fatherland, a jeep would be just the ticket. I tried to stay alert and scan the thick undergrowth for signs of movement, but I was too damn tired and started to nod off. Then the smell hit me. We'd been on a downward slope, and Big Mike braked as we rounded a turn, which emptied us into the open and flat valley floor. The road ran straight through fields and meadows flanked by ditches and overgrown embankments. Bodies were everywhere. Tangled limbs and sprawled torsos displayed in every conceivable form of twisted agony. Burned bodies. Dismembered bodies. Bodies so untouched the men appeared to be sleeping. Beneath them lay bloated bodies, the unfortunates who were first to die on this killing ground, decomposing below the blanket of the most recent victims of our bombs and bullets. Big Mike slowed the jeep to guide it around the rotting remains in the road, then gave up. There were too many on every yard of roadway, so he simply drove over them, avoiding the worst of the entwined dead, leaving them to their final embraces. Shot-up trucks and upended tanks smoldered with acrid fumes, oil and burnt flesh mingling into the perfume of mechanized violence.
My God, Kaz whispered, holding a handkerchief over his mouth. No wonder they were so desperate to get out. I had no idea, I said, the stink of the dead rising into my nostrils. We'd seen the artillery fire and fighter bombers working over the roads from up on Hill 262, but it was all distant and removed, like watching a movie. Here I could see the vehicles shredded by machine gun fire, the bodies blown apart, the scorched and smoking wreckage of everything from tanks to staff cars and bicycles. It was worse than I had ever imagined any hell to be. Hang on, Big Mike said, as he avoided a shell hole in the middle of the road. The jeep swayed as it jolted through the drainage ditch clogged with corpses. I retched at the stench and the sound of cracking bones. Big Mike drove grimly on,
his hands white-knuckled at the wheel. No one spoke. It was like that for miles. Finally, we took a turn on a narrow lane going south. It wasn't the direction the retreating Germans wanted to go, so it was nearly clear. We passed vehicles along the roadside, probably abandoned after they'd run out of fuel. A few dead krauts lay outside one truck, pockets turned out, their weapons and boots gone.
"Watch for the marquee," Kaz said. "That looks like their work. Or nearby villages, if any are left alive. We don't want them mistaking us for the Bosch."
Marquis was one of the all-purpose terms for resistance fighters. Originally, they were young men who escaped into the forests and hills to avoid conscription into the forced labor service, which was basically slave labor. They were named after the scrub brush on the high ground and called Marquisards after they began to arm themselves and fight the occupying Germans. Now, GIs called any French civilian with a weapon a Marquisard. The actual number and variety of resistance groups, spanning all ideologies and beliefs, was too bewildering to keep track of, so an all-purpose name came in handy.
"Slow down," Colonel Harding said,
casually raising his carbine in the direction of the trees ahead.
"I see him, Sam," Big Mike said.
A half dozen Marquisards came out of the trees, pushing two German soldiers ahead of them. The Fritzes looked stunned, dirt and dust staining their faces, fear bleeding out of their eyes. The Frenchmen waved and laughed. They carried canvas bags, weighed down by whatever loot they'd taken from the dead.
"Stop," Harding said.
He told Kaz to ask them if any other Germans were in the area.
"Not alive," Kaz said, after a back and forth with a guy toting a pistol and wearing a black beret and an even blacker mustache. "He says St. Hilaire is 12 kilometers down this road."
"Ask him what group he's with," Harding said. "Are they FTP?
The man laughed when Kaz asked, the leader spitting on the ground before he answered in a torrent, thumping his chest at the end.
"They are not communists," Kaz said. He is rather adamant on that point. "They call themselves the Marquis Henri, and that is Henri. They are from St. Hilaire."
"Tell Henri we will take the prisoners," Harding said. Kaz delivered the message and Henri laughed again. He was having a good time today. I didn't for a minute believe they were real Marquisards, not if they were still living in their village. They didn't have the look of men living rough in the woods. These were Johnny-come-latelys, eager to cash in on easy pickings and glory now that the Germans were gone. Henri spoke again, waving his pistol in the air. Then he shot each German in the back. They crumpled, and he delivered two more shots to finish them off.
"Henri says you may have them now," Kaz said,
carefully adjusting the Sten gun he held in his lap, moving his finger closer to the trigger.
"I think we should depart."
Big Mike didn't wait for the order. He drove off slowly, Kaz and I watching from the rear seat for any sudden moves. Henri and his men glared at us, probably wishing they could pull the boots off our feet as well.
"More like the local mafia than Marquis," Big Mike said once we were clear. "Maybe we should invite them to the show. They'll probably sell out to the highest bidder in no time." "They're bums," Harding said. "Two-bit thugs who wouldn't know how to find a buyer outside their little village. But we might as well get Henri there along with everyone else. You never know."
"Colonel, how about you fill us in?" I said. "What show, and who's invited?"
"There's a briefing scheduled for tomorrow at Patton's headquarters," Harding said, turning to face us. "We've sent out invites to all the resistance leaders in the sector, along with an offer of arms and supplies if they attend," Big Mike put in.
"Right. That'll guarantee the right people get there. Having it at Patton's HQ is part of the draw as well," Harding continued. "Everyone wants to catch a glimpse of Georgie Patton with his silver-plated revolver and cavalry boots. Even the French."
"This briefing is part of the deception campaign, Colonel?" Kaz asked.
"Yes, the centerpiece. As you suspected, we've been advertising our desire for intelligence about German positions around Paris, all up and down the line.
There are enough pro-Vichy French still around that some might be tempted to tip off the Krauts.
There's plenty who retreated with them, Big Mike said. There's a chance their pals or relatives could get word out to them about what we're after. Most of the telephone exchanges are working, so it wouldn't be hard to communicate.
The snarl of aircraft engines rose from over the horizon, quickly growing louder and more insistent. Big Mike pulled off the road into the trees and undercover. We all instinctively ducked as four Thunderbirds roared overhead. From up there, we wouldn't look much different from all the other vehicles they'd bombed and strafed the past few days.
So, we get the resistance people together and brief them on their role in the upcoming attack, Harding said, scanning the sky through the branches. Acting as scouts, protecting our flanks, guarding crossroads, that sort of thing. We make a big deal out of them helping to liberate Paris, Big Mike said. But what you two came up with is the icing on the cake.
Right, Harding said, tapping Big Mike on the shoulder to tell him to drive on.
We're going to put together a map and a set of phony plans and give our unknown traitor a chance to steal them.
So, Kaz said, in a tone that barely disguised his disapproval.
You are going to trick our allies into thinking the liberation of Paris is imminent. Allow a traitor to escape to the Nazis and leave the people of Paris in the hands of the Nazis.
Exactly, Harding said, apparently deciding not to take the bait. We'll get everything set. You two get cleaned up and get some sleep. You deserve it.
Sleep? After what I'd seen in the Valley of Falaise, I was afraid to close my eyes.
Chapter 5. We passed a couple of shot-up trucks and a burned-out German staff car, with no gruesome corpses, a nice change of pace. Big Mike made a turn, and we motored up a driveway over crushed white stone, plane trees planted like sentinels on either side. The entrance was so long it took a while for the chateau to come into sight. 3 stories high, a short city block long, with a gray slate roof and too many chimneys to count. Apple trees dotted the gently rolling hills on one side, as cows grazed in green fields on the other.
Patton knows how to pick 'em, Big Mike said, as we parked the jeep under camouflage netting strung up over the apple trees.
He was right. Not a shell hole or broken window to be seen, with a view of lush hills and a gently flowing river. It was marred somewhat by the collection of army vehicles, tents, and stacks of supplies strewn about, but it was still idyllic compared to much of Normandy on this fine summer's day.
I bet the Krauts who had to leave this place were sorry, I said, grabbing my pack as we climbed out of the jeep.
They didn't get far, Harding said, leading the way to a row of tents set up in the orchard. Those vehicles you saw out on the road? That was the German convoy, ambushed by the St. Just Brigade, one of the larger FTP bands.
Yes, we spoke to a young man, Jules Herbert, who is part of that unit, Kaz said. A communist, but he seems dedicated.
They're good fighters, Harding said. That's why I'm surprised one of them is a traitor. They hate the Germans almost as much as they despise the French fascists. There are
many reasons. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.